Good evening, everyone. If you don't mind, stand on your feet as we sing praises to our God. Clap your hands, everybody, if you can. Hey. Come on and sing, sing.
Sing to the Lord.
Open up.
Open up your heart. Make a joyful noise in the sanctuary. Sing, sing unto the Lord. Light is God with love. Let the praises ring in the sanctuary.
Come on and sing. I gotta open up your mouth.
Open up your mouth and give God praise. Open up your heart and give God praise. Give the holy hand unashamed in the sanctuary. Gotta open up your mouth and give God praise. Gotta open up your heart and give God praise. Give the holy hand unashamed in the sanctuary. Gotta open up your mouth and give God praise. Open up your heart and give God praise. Give the holy hand unashamed in the sanctuary. Open up your mouth and give God praise. Open up your heart and give God praise. Lift up holy hands unashamed.
Come on, clap your hands, everybody. Hey! Sing unto.
To the Lord, open up your heart.
Make a joyful noise.
Make a joyful noise in the sanctuary.
Sing,
sing unto the Lord.
Lavish God with love.
Lavish God with love. Let the praises ring in the sanctuary.
Sing, sing,
sing unto the Lord. Open up your heart.
Make a
joyful noise in the sanctuary.
Sing,
sing unto the Lord. Lavish God with love. Let the praises ring in the sanctuary.
Sing.
Woo! Yeah. I'm pressing on.
I'm pressing on the upward way.
New heights I'm gaining.
New heights I'm gaining.
Every day.
Every day. Still praying on. I'm onward bound. Let my feet on higher ground.
Oh, lift me up. Oh, lift me up.
Oh, lift me up.
And let me stand.
And let me stand.
Within that free.
Within that free.
And promised land.
Promised land.
Higher plane,
a higher plane
that I have found.
Let my feet on higher ground.
My heart has
no desire to stay where bigotry and hate dismay. Though some may dwell. Within that free
and promised land,
a higher plane.
I want to live in a new world though
shameful dark and me will hurt.
I'll listen
for that joyful sound, that song of strength on higher ground.
Oh, lift us up. Oh, lift us up.
Oh, lift us up.
And let us stand.
And let us stand.
Within that free.
Within that free.
And promised land.
Promised land.
A higher plane.
A higher plane.
That we have found.
That we have found.
Sing, plant
my feet on higher ground.
I like this hymn.
I want to run till I can find. When they go low, we will go high. Still praying till that land we found. God lead us on.
Oh, lift us up,
oh, lift us up,
and let us stand,
and let us stand
within that free,
within that free,
and promised land,
a higher plane
that we have found.
Sing,
bend our feet
on higher.
Come on, one more. Oh, lift us. Oh, lift us up.
Oh, lift us up
and let us stand.
And let us stand
within that free.
Within that free.
And promised land.
A higher plane
that we have found.
Well, higher ground. Hello, class of 2023. Let us raise a shout. God is good, and we are here. We are here in the Worley Chapel. We are here in the Schreyer Commons. We are here in the Zoom room. We are here on Facebook Live. And wherever we are in the power of the Holy Spirit, we are all gathered up in the same energy and goodness of God's love to give thanks and share joy for all that has been accomplished by these amazing honorees and the 173rd graduating class of Eden Theological Seminary. Welcome to each and every one of you, your beloved ones gathered with you, and all who join to celebrate the journey of theological education in this community of learning and faith. I am Deb Kraus, proud to be the president of Eden Seminary. Thank you. And on behalf of our fabulous faculty, our spirited staff, and our trustworthy trustees, I welcome you all to this most cherished of all occasions in our mission, the conferral of well-earned degrees and recognition for our amazing honorees and graduates. You all are a bright light of Eden's call and purpose. And we dedicate tonight our worship and ceremony in great thanksgiving and praise to God, who has brought us thus far and to whom belongs all the glory. Amen. So we've drawn a little bit of a short straw with the weather. I'm sure that you encountered that on the way in. But fear not, Eden's intrepid staff has it covered. So join us in the Rand Rotunda below this floor in the middle of the building and in the hallways and rooms around for a reception after the ceremony and a chance to greet the graduates and honorees. Now, speaking of Eden's staff, they are amazing. They are listed on the final page of this bulletin, and I won't name them all, but in all things and all ways, we owe them a great debt of gratitude for all they do, not only for this event, but for the operations and administration of Eden Seminary each and every day. Thank you. You join me in reading aloud our opening prayer. Gracious One, you have led us and kept us. Who are we that you have loved us so well? As we stand on the threshold of a new season, listening for Jesus' call to follow in each new day, our hearts overflow with gratitude when we think of all you have done. Through these years of learning, as we have stretched our minds to understand and learn to make peace with mystery, as we have found our voices to speak of justice and practiced how to stand with others who are pushed aside, as we have studied the art of tending our own gardens so that fruits of the Spirit may grow in our hearts, through all of this, you have blessed us time and again. When we were uncertain, you sent us assurance in the form of friends or strangers. When we lost our way, you gently pushed and prodded our intentions back into the contours of your grace. When we were weighed down with isolation and grief, or when we threw up our hands, convinced that the world was torn beyond repair, even then you were steadfast, reworking the tender places in our hearts, reforming courage, vision, and resolve. And so we declare and do testify what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked upon and touched with our own hands. Scripture has been fulfilled in our hearing, and your kingdom of shalom has come near
time and again. We have heard the songs of the captives and have seen the dawning smiles of outcasts welcomed home. We have touched the smooth, fading scars of healing and have seen the ministry of Jesus, your anointed, go forever despite all the forces of death. Because of all this and more, we rejoice and offer you our humble thanks, along with the balance of our days, committed to the cause of your compassion, praying in the name of Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit lights our way. Amen.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus, my Savior.
You brought me, yes, you brought me from a mighty long way.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus,
my Savior,
God. You brought me, yes, you brought me from a mighty long way.
You've been my father,
you've been my mother,
you've been my sister,
my brother too.
Oh,
you brought me, yes, you brought me from a mighty long way.
You've been my father,
you've been my mother,
you've been my sister,
my brother too. Oh, you brought me, yes, you brought me from a mighty long way.
Come on and say, I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus,
my Savior.
My Savior, God. Oh,
you brought me.
Yes, you brought me from a mighty long way. Mighty long way.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus.
I thank you, Jesus,
thank you, Jesus, my Savior, God.
You brought me, yes, you brought me from a mighty
long way.
A reading from the 21st chapter of the Gospel of John, in which we get a glimpse of a controversy within John's community about how long the disciple will live. Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them. He was the one who had reclined next to Jesus at the supper and had said, "Lord, who is it that is going to betray you?" When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus said to him, "If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? Follow me." So the rumor spread in the community that this disciple would not die. Yet Jesus did not say to him that he would not die, but, "If it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you?" This is the disciple who is testifying to these things and has written them, and we know that this testimony is true. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
It is my honor to introduce our preacher for this evening, Reverend, very soon to be Doctor, Muriel Johnson. Really needs no introduction in this space. An esteemed graduate of Eden Seminary, she was, in those days, invited by the faculty her senior year to preach the senior sermon at our annual spring convocation service in 1993. Faculty of that season remember Muriel as a fearless leader of her class, bold to speak out against institutional injustice and quick to defend those injured by institutional inequities. adjudicatory leader in the American Baptist Church for 20 years of service prior to her well-earned retirement. Reverend Johnson is known throughout all parts of the church as a brilliant preacher, a purposeful mentor, a beloved pastor to pastors, and a moral conscience of the church and society. Later in this ceremony, Reverend Johnson will indeed be conferred an honorary Doctor of Divinity by the Eden Faculty and Board of Trustees. This conferral is rooted in her faithfulness to be authentically and unapologetically who God has called her to be in ministry, and the ways that faithfulness has contributed to Eden Seminary in its mission. So, with great thanksgiving and profound gratitude, I ask you to join me and the entire Eden community in welcoming Reverend Johnson, along with her wonderful family and supporting guests gathered with us, to this preaching moment. Reverend Johnson.
You may. Okay, I'm going to get it together. I graduated from this seminary 30 years ago. And what I said after I left was that I would never preach in this chapel again. Never told everybody, black folks, white folks, and everybody in between, not gonna do it. But God has a way of making fools of us in our foolish promises. And so here I am back, doing what I said I would never do, and I'm going to break all the rules. And I'm breaking the rules because when President called me, I said, you really want me to do this? Now? At such a time as this? With what's going on in the world? And she said, yeah, bring it. So here I am. And so I just would just like to spend a few minutes just in that chapter of the Gospel of John. You know, the chapter is full of theological jewels. We are told that the story unfolds by the Sea of Galilee. That's where Jesus walked on water and calmed the storm, and Peter and Andrew were called there to be fishers of people. Yeah, I'm an Eden graduate. People. and it was a strange grouping in this story. You know, you gotta set that text into context. And it's a strange grouping. First of all, there was only seven of them there. So where were the other four? Not to mention that two of the disciples that were named, Thomas and Nathaniel, they had no connection with fishing at all. What they was doing on a boat trying to catch some fish is beyond me. Because they were more like me. What I know about fish is like I like coleslaw and tartar sauce. Okay? So what they were doing, we don't even know. But it's clear to me that here they are, hanging out together. And you gotta wonder, this is a post-resurrection appearance. You know, I mean, they've all, you know, Jesus has already got up. And they've had some experiences, but they're still kind of, can I say confused? Can I say disillusioned? Can I say they were still looking for something? because they didn't quite know what was going on. And so when crazy happens in the world, and when crazy happens in your life, you have a tendency to want to go back to the things you used to do. You know, the last words of the church is, we've never done it like this. And they may be the last words of some churches. Because in these days and times, to say that you've never done it like this is to close yourself to the possibility that God will do a new thing in you. In your church, in your midst, in your chaplaincy, in your wherever you serve, wherever you are, God might want to do a new thing. And here you are with all your luggage, all your issues, your issues. You done took the Bible, got your good tools, and reinterpreted it to fit your world. That's the difference between exegesis and eisegesis. I learned that here. You know, sometimes we want to just make the church look like us. I'll get back to that later. But this is all going on, and you got to think about this in John. Here is Peter, right? Peter, who had flunked at every juncture. Peter, who open mouth put foot in it all the time. Peter, who actually was walking on water and then took his eye off Jesus and sunk. Peter. And so here they are, this strange grouping, and they're still hanging out together. And you wonder, you know, but I guess anytime you hang out with Jesus, a group of people, or two or three, and you walk and you stay in that word and you try to learn, there's a bond that forms with you. So you stay together, or at least some of us do. So inquiring minds might want to know, well, why would you want to do this and talk about this at the graduation of a class who's getting ready to go out, who's excited, passed your orals, finished all of that stuff. You know you're getting your degree, your family is here, and you're ready. We're getting ready to turn you loose. On the church, on the community, in the hospitals. God forbid, there you go out there operating with a dull scalpel. Because as good as the tools that we have and that we got in this place, when you get out in the real world, the people will let you know real quick, yeah, that's nice. I love your theology and I love your God talk. But let me tell you about my life. I need something real. I don't need you to tell me about the already and the not yet. Even if I need to know, I don't understand. But when you take these tools and you break them down and you start to work with them in your scalpel, then you begin to create situations and scenarios that begin to let you breathe. Breathe in scripture, breathe in the spirit. You get space to do things and think things that you didn't think before. You know, you learn about other people. One thing about coming to Eden, and this is gonna be my testimony, so y'all just work with me here. Don't get insulted, I'm just being honest. When I came here because my father in the gospel graduated from here. Yes, he did. And I came here, and after 1 week, I had decided, I'm not sure these people are saved. I'm serious. And I was trying to be cool about it because, you know, I was a child, a product of busing. I grew up in the projects in Brooklyn, New York. I hung out with all kinds of folks, you know. So I'm like, I'm pretty cool. I said, but you know, these UCC folks, I didn't even know what UCC was. I said, ooh, and so I'm gonna tell you this little joke. Don't tell nobody, okay? But I used to tell people, if roaches organize, the UCC will take them in. And you know, for those of us who know about roaches, we ain't trying to. Now we know all God's children got a place in the choir, the critters, everybody. But roaches are not my friend. And so in Eden, I began to wonder, you know, wait a minute, what's going on here? But it was at Eden that I learned to sing the songs of Zion in a strange land. It was at Eden, sitting over in one of those, there used to be pews back there, when I would cry when I understood that psalm that said, oh, they required of us to sing a song. Because I was in a strange place, in a strange land. And the class of 93, if any of y'all are here, y'all know we was buck crazy. We argued about everything. We were one extreme to the other. And in that time of the seminary life, we were being communitized. That was the word. You had to take a community class because it was going to make us live and be with each other and love each other. We hated each other more. By the time I got finished with the community class, one of them classes, somebody had put a Bible on the floor, slid it across. Somebody had put their foot on it. My black church tradition, I almost just fell over and died before Jesus right there. Oh, Lord! They done took the holy word and threw it on the floor. That happened here at Eden. It was here at Eden that after I preached in that convocation, right over in that section, right over there, I'm telling it all today. I was coming out, and one of the graduates said, loud enough, the reunion class said, I guess Eden can't teach white people how to preach no more, huh? That is what caused me to say I would never preach in this place again. Because I knew then what I know now, that people can make their mouth say anything. And here we are, the Eden Theological Seminary, progressive and full of justice. Racism was prevalent everywhere. But we were trying to make do while we were undone. And there was, look, y'all got alumni. Look, we got these fancy things. We didn't have this when I came. The African Americans could have met in a phone booth. Some of y'all are old enough to know what a phone booth is. We didn't have that, you know. And so here we were. And it was in this place, though. I don't even need this. It was in this place. It was in this place that some of my preaching brothers, whom I studied with, who didn't believe in preaching women, got convicted. I'm not gonna call his name, but I laugh about it every time I hear the story. He just was walking around the quad. It was before it was real fancy. And our apartment, we lived in the guest apartment, my daughter. She said she lived in a closet, but that's another story. And so here we are, and all of this is going on in this place, this Eden place. And you know, and they keep telling me, oh, we're so liberal. We're about justice. We want to treat everybody right. Then they start talking this stuff about inclusive language. Now that's part of your world now. But that wasn't a part of our world. I didn't even understand what the problem was. I was like, in my church tradition, we say God was a mother and a father to me, a brother and a sister. I had no orientation for that. I did not understand that. And so it was in this place that I learned what I believed, why I believed what I believed. I knew it. And I began to define it and understand it as something bigger than just my world and my view and my church. And I also was living under the oppression that most people of color live under when you're in a predominantly white space, is you got to behave yourself. Right, Dr. O? Huh? You got to carry yourself in such a way that you represent the race well. As women, you know, you got to dress right, Tracy. You can't just be running around with leopard print skirts and black collars on. It was in this place that all of that happened. And so
One of the things that reminds me as I sit here and talk about this, and say, well, why would you bring all this up now? I bring this up because the class of 2023, you going out into a public space that is so ugly, so vile. It's got those of us who love the Lord questioning whether or not we can still be the beloved community. I've been struggling with this because, you know, some of us have been Don Lemons before. Some of us have lost churches because of our theology. Some of us have had to leave churches because our own isms, our own sexism, our own prejudices was killing not only us, but everybody in the pews too. But it was in this place that God sent someone before I came whom I did not know and who did not know me. But he loved me and he loved us and he poured into us. I'll never forget the one time I thought I had disappointed him because I used to sing with the band over in the Commons. Yes, it was holy music. I understand now that we created that line between sacred and secular music, but I was over there singing Sam Cooke because y'all were killing me in the chapel. Okay? So I'm over there, and so he came by one day, one Friday night, you know, evening, sister, I want you to remember that you came here to get a degree. You said to me, don't lose focus. And Dr. Oglesby, you paid a price in this place for those of us that we. I come back to this space and reclaim it because I'm Eden too. And so are you. And so, Dr. O, everywhere we go, am I right, Freddie? Everywhere we go, people say, you know, you and Freddie have the same theology. I said, no, me and Freddie had the same professor. He taught us ethical behavior. He taught us dignity. He respected us and he loved us. And so in this place, in this space, because we are Eden and this is part of our story, I wrap you in this.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
There are those of us who wouldn't have made it if it hadn't been for him. And for those of us who have worked in white space and institutions, you know it takes an extra piece and an extra thing on your family. And I used to give me what we have from Miss Gloria. And we know the sacrifice. We know that you kept making a way for us. But we also know that we know that you always had his back. So here's the deal, back to the text, right? This is part of the text. Because here Peter is restored, right? And here he's already, oh, hey, baby, he's already. He looked back and saw John and said, well, what about him? And I messed with that text. I'm limping with it. I was like, well, what's wrong with that question? What about him? Well, it's the motivation behind the question, right? What about him? Did you leave him out? What about him? Because he was more faithful than anyone else. What about him? Is he going to get left? Okay. What about him? So I tried to work it, you know, but I knew my Eden tools just wouldn't let me eisegete that thing the way I wanted to. It's amazing how often God and the scriptures agrees with my point of view. You would be amazed. Clue. Jesus didn't like that question. He didn't ask about the motivation, but he didn't like that question because he went off, didn't he? In the text, right? He said, well, this ain't your business. I told you to follow me. You got your car. What you worried about her car for? What is this? Jesus is not happy with that. And what I came to say today is that what about me stuff? He gave me my first A in an election. 33 years ago, I was so proud. Oh, geez. I really was. And there we were. Just all of this is going on. What about me? What about me? And when I wrestled with this sermon, I used to say, I thank God for the African American students that came after me. Because if it had not been for y'all, I would have never come back. The only time I ever came back was when Dr. O asked me, or when one of the students asked me to do something. Because I knew I had a shared experience with them, and I had a love for them. And I want to thank y'all right now for keeping me tied to this thing. Because I would have never had this moment to say thank you. Thank you for following in the legacy of what we represent in this place. We are not second thoughts. We are not. Why would black folks come to the Eden Theological Seminary? It's a mystery. But there's a lot of good stuff behind it. But there's a lot of ugly stuff behind it. But I want to thank all of you for that moment. And for the class of 2023, I want to say to you, the tools that I got here were extraordinary. I know they were extraordinary because I could beat some of my professors with them later. Oh, yes. We got great joy. Great joy. I got great joy in saying, well, you told me this. And Dr. All taught me that I have to learn to live in the tension between the already and the not yet. But I'm going to tell y'all, these last few years, I've been looking a little sideways about this beloved community. We're being attacked, Jewish synagogues, guns, our communities, all of this ugly, ugly stuff, the politics, and we running around talking about, but we are a Christian nation. Prove it! Why? Why? So I'm here to tell you, class of 2023, as you go out here, wherever you go, you got your call, right? Because I was amazed when I got here. Some of my classmates had never preached. I'm like, how can this be? In the black church tradition, you didn't dare come to seminary and you had never preached. I'm like, what do you mean you never preached? What kind of church do you come from? And look, and back in the day, they called it the trial sermon. It was serious. You know, you just didn't go over there and talk about no ABC, do the red print, and sit down. It was serious. They were going to vote. But here, you've got the tools now. But don't think so highly of yourself with those tools that you forget that that's all they are tools. You still got to meet the people where they are. You still got to serve. You still got to recognize you got a call, and it's your call. You got to know that it's the call that God placed in your life, and it was designed just for you. It wasn't designed for him and his. And if you stop asking what about and what about and just do what Jesus had told us to do, because the call says follow me. The call says imitate me. The call says my professor taught me the imago Dei of God. The image of God is my capacity to love. It has nothing to do with how I look on the outside. It's my capacity to love and be with people whom I don't particularly care for. Did you hear what I said? I don't like some of y'all. Let me be clear. I don't even like this spot over here. I'm sorry you're sitting there. Okay. I'm going to stay over here. But we serve a God that if we accept this call, we have to put aside our own luggage and our own stuff. We have to say, I want to follow Jesus. You got to be able to speak about your hurts and your pain and call out injustice where it is. Because what I learned from my professor was that I am never going to let the image, my image created, my imago Dei, I'm not going to have God look at me and say, your ism kept you from loving this or that. I want God to look at me and say, yes, you love like me. Yes, even those ones you don't like and you don't agree with, you still should be able to sit down and worry and talk with one another. So I came to tell you, class of 2023, that had it not been for the Eden experience, and had it not been for the blood, the sweat, and the tears, and had not been for a faculty who was able to look even beyond their own racial isms and see different things in us, I would not be the person I am today. And I'm grateful to say that it's one thing to be healed. One of my sisters taught me this, but it's a whole other thing to recover. But I have recovered, and I came back to this place to say, you want to be Eden? You want to lean in? I'm Eden. You got to lean in with my story. I'm going to lean in with your story. Don't get mad when I bring up things that I think are unjust. Just know that I took the tools that we had all together, and I'm trying to follow Jesus. I noticed, Chris, I love the way y'all do these lyrics, because that's all another thing about Eden. I learned some songs I never knew in my life. You know, but I worked with a multicultural congregation, so it was good. It was like, how do you know that song? I learned that at Eden. But now I notice y'all just changed some words up on some songs I knew all my life. I'm like, wait a minute, when did that happen?
Tell me about it.
The class of 2023. How am I doing, Chris? Time wise? Because I promised I wouldn't go too long. I'm going to bring it home. So class of 2023, we're going to slide through all of this and say, the call. That's what brought you here, I hope. And when you leave here, I hope you take the call with you. I hope you personalize it. Not that you own it, but that God owns you. That your partnership and your dedication to the call will make you reach past the things that you would normally do. You'll come back and preach in a chapel where you were wounded. You will come back to a place that they're going to give me some dead hollers when I say this. My grandfather in the gospel says that an honorary doctorate is donated dignity. I came to get my donated dignity. Because, you know, we're proud that we earned it, but I came to get my donated dignity. And I said, and my aunt in the gospel, who is an Eden graduate too, says, but you did earn it. You didn't earn it in the classroom. You earned it in your ministry. You earned it in the community. So I'm going to tell y'all what. I'm going to take this donated dignity, and I'm going to say, if you can remember anything about all the things that I shared with you, is that we have the potential to be the beloved community. Because in this space, we have seen things transformed. There are things that I have been transformed about in this place, even with the wounds. And now that I know, that I know, that I know that God is a healer, but I also know that God is a restorer. And I want y'all to know I got my eyes on you. So don't come running up to me talking about, you my Eden sister. Because I found out when somebody has their foot on your neck, It doesn't matter if it's a Stacey Adams or a high heel. A foot on the neck is a foot on the neck. We've got to be authentic with each other. And we've got to put our hands together and move forward for such a time as this. Class of 2023, I claim you. What about your call? What about your isms? What about your preferences? What about your service? Whose feet are you going to wash that you never wanted to touch or be with? When are you going to get over your stuff long enough to help those who are being victimized by systems that are just so unrelentlessly oppressive? When are we going to fix the road and stop feeling good about the little charity we do as we do little things in the community? Fix the road. Fix the institution, Deb. Fix those things. And so when I tell you it's about the call, it's about the service, it's about the never-ending leaning in to God. So when you see me or you hear me say, I am Eden, I want you to know I'm proud of it. I'm not proud of the pain, but I'm proud of the God that healed me and restored me. I'm proud of the people in this place who reached the cross and helped make a difference in the world. And that's going to be our story. Because we are Eden.
All right.
Everywhere we are.
Yes, I'm grateful for the victories we've won. I could go on and on and on about your word, because I'm grateful, grateful, so grateful just to praise you, Lord. Flowing from my heart are the issues of my heart. His gratefulness. Things that you have done.
Yes,
I'm grateful for the victories we've won. I could go on and on and on about your word, because I'm grateful, grateful, so grateful just to praise you, Lord. Knowing from my heart are the issues of my heart, His gratefulness.
Reverend Johnson, for that good, authentic, unflinchingly true word. And thank you, Minister Jordan and the band. Amen. Now we move to the awarding of degrees. We begin with our honorary
Doctor of Divinity degrees. Please watch the screens.
The faculty and board of trustees of Eden Theological Seminary are regularly inspired by the ministries and leadership of Eden Seminary alumni as they embody the vision, mission, and values of the school. This year, Eden is delighted to spotlight the ministry, scholarship, and leadership of the Reverend Muriel L. Johnson and to confer upon her the honorary degree, Doctor of Divinity. The Reverend Muriel Johnson is a native of Biloxi, Mississippi, where her father served in the Air Force. Reverend Johnson later relocated with her parents, Mary and Bobby, to Brooklyn, New York. She grew up in the Brownsville-Tilden Projects, a community that shaped her determination and dreams. The combination of her Southern roots and her growing up in public housing shaped and still inform her worldview. Reverend Johnson began her college matriculation at the University of Wisconsin and later transferred to Harris Stowe State College in St. Louis, where she earned a Bachelor of Science degree in Urban Education. After accepting her call into the ministry almost 40 years ago, Reverend Johnson earned her Master of Divinity degree from Eden Theological Seminary. With the Wisconsin Department of Health and Social Services, Reverend Johnson held several positions aiding families with dependent children, including Native American tribal communities. Most of her early work life focused on program strategies designed to develop leadership skills for youth, adults, creating programs to keep in-risk youth in school and out of prison, preventing teenage pregnancy, and promoting grassroots community organizing. She is an ordained American Baptist minister. She accepted her call into ministry and was the first woman licensed by Mount Zion Baptist Church in Madison. She has served congregations in Wisconsin and Missouri in various pastoral positions. From congregational ministry, Reverend Johnson was called to the regional ministry and served as the Executive Regional Associate Minister for the American Baptist Churches of the Great Rivers region for 20 years. She was the first African-American ministry leader called to this position. While there, her preaching and teaching gifts, her deep understanding of church structures, culture, outreach, and hospitality are hallmarks of her ministry. Reverend Johnson is blessed with an adult daughter, Aisha, a godson, Carvon, as well as a newly minted 18-year-old grandson, Maurice Jamal. She currently resides in Suffolk, Virginia. In her spare time, she is the chief executive officer of Bishops Inc., LLC, a clergy congregation and community consultation firm that she established based on her God-given gifts, academic preparation, and years of professional experience. It is with great thanksgiving for her pastoral legacy, mentorship, and service to the community and church that the faculty and board of trustees of Eden Theological Seminary is delighted to recommend the Reverend Muriel L. Johnson for the conferral of the degree, Doctor of Divinity, and all the rights and privileges thereof.
The faculty and board of trustees of Eden Theological Seminary are so pleased to recognize this evening a person who has contributed immeasurably to the education and formation of our students and to the life and mission of this school for over 30 years. To borrow a phrase from the Tanakh, the Nevi'im, to be more precise, the prophets, Rabbi Howard G. Kaplansky is a man after God's own heart. That is to say, a servant. After receiving a BA degree from The Ohio State University, he was ordained rabbi at Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion, where he earned a Master of Arts in Hebrew Letters and where he was later awarded a DD. Rabbi Kaplansky served local congregations in Springfield, Massachusetts and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, before coming to St. Louis, where he served United Hebrew Congregation for over 30 years, including as senior rabbi from 1990 to 2011, at which time he became Rabbi Emeritus of the congregation. But the focus of Rabbi Kaplansky's time and energy has been much wider than local congregations. He has served as director of the Midwest Council of American Hebrew Congregations, now known as the Union for Reform Judaism. He has served as president of the St. Louis Jewish Community Relations Council, the St. Louis Rabbinical Association, the Association of Reform Rabbis, and the American Jewish Committee St. Louis Region. He has served on numerous boards of trustees, including the Jewish Federation of St. Louis, Jewish Family and Children's Service, St. Louis Jewish Light, the Urban League of Metropolitan St. Louis, St. Louis Care and Counseling, and the Interfaith Partnership of St. Louis. He has served as Vice President of the St. Louis Interfaith Clergy Council and of Doorways St. Louis, as well as the first chairperson of the Michael and Barbara Newmark Institute on Human Relations. And as suggested a few moments ago, Rabbi Kaplansky has served Eden Theological Seminary for over 30 years as an adjunct professor in Judaic studies and theology. By way of his teaching and his example, Rabbi Kaplansky has given our students a deeper understanding of Judaism. He has prepared them to think and work interfaithfully in their future ministries, and he has inspired them to pursue the Mishpat, Tzedek, and Shalom, the justice, righteousness, and peace, or comprehensive well-being, as I prefer to translate Shalom, the peace that God wills for humankind and for the whole creation. With deep appreciation and abundant thanksgiving for his service to local congregations, his service to Judaism in St. Louis and beyond, his service to the interfaith community of St. Louis and to the entire St. Louis region and community, and for his service to Eden Theological Seminary, the faculty of Eden Theological Seminary is delighted to recommend Rabbi Howard G. Kaplansky for the conferral of the degree Doctor of Divinity.
The faculty and Board of Trustees of Eden Theological Seminary encourage bold Christian discipleship as integral to the mission of the school and the life of the church. Tonight, we honor Mrs. Norma Clemmie for such discipleship. Norma is a layperson with a passion for the church's role in social transformation. She is married to the Reverend Armin Clemmie, Eden class of 1950, and third generation of Eden alumni. Norma and Armin are blessed by four children, four grandchildren, and two great-grandchildren. Norma is a leader in the church and community. She grew up in St. Joseph, Missouri, and taught school for 18 years, serving alongside Reverend Armin in churches in Sedalia, Herman, and Jefferson City. Norma and Armin then settled in Union, Missouri, where she continued for 20 years as a substitute teacher in the public schools and to serve actively in her congregation of Zion United Church of Christ. Norma currently provides leadership for Zion UCC's Green Team for Environmental Justice. Norma is a connector in the community. She has decades of experience in seeing a need, recognizing organizations in that space, and connecting those organizations to act. Norma has been active through the years in the Missouri Mid-South Conference of the United Church of Christ. She has taught by example how to organize community church partnerships. Organizations including food pantries in Franklin County and Habitat for Humanity have benefited for decades from her vision and leadership. Norma is an influencer. She is well-respected, compassionate, and encouraging. People listen to Norma. They get involved. From recycling and gardening to the Festival of Sharing Board and Crop Hunger Walks for Food Security, her family, friends, and church have been instrumental in everything she attempts. In 2012, Norma decided to celebrate 80 years of blessings by walking 80 miles, 1 mile a day. With the generosity of friends throughout the Missouri Mid-South Conference, she raised significant funds for the Crop Walk of Church World Service, Emmaus Homes, Habitat for Humanity, and the UCC's Our Church's Wider Mission. A decade later, to celebrate 90 years, Norma again walked and organized her networks, encouraging generous donations to the Crop Walk, Hope Ranch, the UCC's Our Church's Wider Mission, and Eden Theological Seminary. Norma gives thanks for people she has been blessed to know and who have mentored her. She is guided by the words of her confirmation verse, Colossians 3:17. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. I am pleased to announce that the faculty of Eden Theological Seminary enthusiastically recommends Norma Clemmie for the conferral of the degree Doctor of Humane Letters.
In the early decades of the 20th century, a church leader in the emerging ecumenical movement of the German evangelical and reformed traditions, Samuel D. Press, was gathering resources to strengthen the mission of Eden Seminary as it adapted to the quickly shifting landscape of the church, as well as the institutional demands of North American higher education. As the president of Eden from 1919 to 1941, Press would establish the school on its third campus, this time in Webster Groves, and engage other ecumenical leaders on the topic of church unity, a topic that would ultimately give rise to the United Church of Christ. The building in which many of us are physically assembled tonight is named Press Hall in his honor. Samuel Press set a high standard at Eden Seminary for both relying upon God's provision and moving with purpose and vision in order to be faithful and responsive to the movement of the Holy Spirit and to live out a vision of unity within the peace and justice of Jesus Christ. Only occasionally, as the fruit of Samuel Press's legacy and love for this school and its mission is particularly evident, the faculty and trustees of Eden Seminary act to confer the Samuel D. Press Service Award to persons who powerfully embody the values and ethos of Dr. Press's vocation. Tonight, I am honored to share the citation for the conferral of the Samuel D. Press Service Award to the Reverend Dr. Veronica Jean Richardson. It saddens the entire Eden community to confer this award posthumously, but we do so with thanksgiving, not only for Pastor V's life and ministry, but also with celebration that many of her family and friends are here to receive the award on her behalf. Her spirit is truly with us in this place. The Reverend Dr. Veronica Richardson was a beloved member of the Eden graduating class of 2013. While pursuing her MDiv at Eden, Veronica brought her vibrant and multi-vocational gifts for ministry to this community. She broke open the resources of her healthcare profession, anchored by a BSN and RN, with certification as a healthcare educator, and merged them with her Christian faith and her theological education, both an MDiv and DMin, to create a platform for ministry that was rooted in community and moving toward healing and wholeness for all God's people. With passion and purpose, the Reverend Dr. Richardson, also known affectionately as Pastor V, Ronnie, Sissy, T, and beloved Aunt Bud, shared her gifts with the Eden community. Following her graduation, Veronica maintained networks of connection through the Eden Black Alumni Association, the Eden faculty and staff, and the vast numbers of churches and friends with whom she shared fellowship and love. In those networks, without seeking attention or fanfare, she listened for where the needs were. Hearing that some students faced challenges, she quietly secured healthcare resources for over a decade of Eden students in her relationship with Affinia Healthcare, ensuring access to affordable and often free medical care for any Eden students who needed it. She offered her pastoral vision and expertise as the director of the Baptist House of Studies at Eden, offering support and encouragement to students navigating their calls to ministry. She offered her wisdom on church leadership in collaboration with Eden faculty to support Eden students in their vocational discernment. As if this record were not enough, Veronica, during the challenging days of the pandemic, reached out to the seminary as vaccines were first being made available and secured access to vaccines for the entire Eden faculty and staff. In this regard, she once again supported the seminary in its mission, moving in humility and faith to extend the resources from her networks in order to support the health and wholeness of God's people. With her gifts of network resources and caring attention, Veronica Richardson put the faculty and staff of the seminary on a safe footing from which to pursue the seminary's mission during this most dangerous global pandemic. For this legacy of service and care, by action of the Eden Seminary faculty and trustees, be it known that the Reverend Dr. Veronica Jean Richardson is a recipient of the Samuel D. Press Award for service to Eden Theological Seminary. We share this award in the hearing of the assembled Eden community at this, our 173rd commencement services, with thanksgiving for her life and ministry, and in celebration of her transforming care and compassion shared in this community of learning and faith, for the well-being of the faculty, staff, and students, and to the glory of God.
Will the candidates for the Honorary Doctor of Divinity degree please rise in body or spirit? President Krauss and Chairperson Rowe, on behalf of the faculty, I am privileged to present to you the candidates for Eden Seminary's Honorary Doctor of Divinity degree.
As chair of Eden Theological Seminary's Board of Trustees, I am pleased to receive the faculty's recommendation. In consultation with members of the board, I commend these candidates to the president for the conferral of the degree.
By virtue of the authority granted to Eden Theological Seminary through its charter, and by action of the faculty and Board of Trustees, I confer upon you the Honorary Doctor of Divinity degree, and declare you entitled to all attendant rights and privileges.
Reverend Muriel L. Johnson. Rabbi Howard Kaplansky. And congratulations again to these honorees. Will the candidate for the Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters degree please rise in body or spirit? President Krauss and Chairperson Rowe, on behalf of the faculty, I am privileged to present to you the candidate for Eden Seminary's Honorary Doctorate of Humane Letters degree.
As chair of Eden Theological Seminary's Board of Trustees, I am pleased to receive the faculty's recommendation. In consultation with members of the board, I commend this candidate to the president for the conferral of the degree.
By virtue of the authority granted to Eden Theological Seminary through its charter, and by action of the faculty and Board of Trustees, I confer upon you the Honorary Doctor of Humane Letters degree and declare you entitled to all attendant rights and privileges.
Mrs. Norma Fleming. Please join me in congratulating this honoree. Will the family members receiving the Samuel D. Press Service Award on behalf of Veronica Richardson please rise in body or spirit?
Beautiful family of Veronica Richardson, by action of the Board of Trustees, we are pleased to present Reverend Dr. Veronica Richardson posthumously with the Samuel B. Press Service Award, with our thanks for her dedicated service to the Eden Seminary community and to the community at large. Amen. Amen.
Please join us in giving thanks for this award recipient and praise to God for her life and ministry.
Will the candidates for the Doctor of Ministry degree please rise in body or spirit? President Krause and Chairperson Rowe, these candidates have satisfactorily completed the requirements for the degree Doctor of Ministry. On behalf of the faculty, it is my privilege to recommend them for the conferral of the degree.
As Chair of Eden Theological Seminary's Board of Trustees, I am pleased to receive the faculty's recommendation. In consultation with the members of the board, I commend these candidates to the president for the conferral of the degree.
By virtue of the authority granted Eden Theological Seminary through its charter, and by action of the faculty and Board of Trustees, we confer upon you the degree Doctor of Ministry and declare you entitled to all attendant rights and privileges.
Richard Bruxvort Colligan, joining us on Zoom.
Richard.
Oh, look, there he is.
Richard currently serves as cantor at Olive Branch Community and ECLA congregation in Rochester, Minnesota, and as a composer of worship songs for the wider church. After graduation, he will continue to work at Olive Branch as a music leader and guide for spiritual formation. He is grateful to his wife, Trish, son, Sam, mom, Eva, and sister, Amy, for their love and support.
Marion Edmonds Allen.
Marion is the executive director of Parity, a New York-based national nonprofit that works at the intersection of faith and LGBT concerns. After graduation, she will continue to work at the intersection of faith and the LGBTQIA+ concerns, running to catch up with whatever the Holy Spirit is up to. All of her thanks goes to her advisor, Dr. Niles, her wife, Tori, and her kids, JJ, David, Giacomo, and Jerry. She is not the only one who is glad that this chapter is complete. Thanks also to Eden for giving her a home and giving her wings.
Diane Hampton, joining us via Zoom.
Diane currently serves as Deputy Command Chaplain at Marine Corps Installation, East Marine Corps Base, Camp Lejeune. She hopes to remain in the Navy, supporting Marine Sailors Coasties until her retire. She would like to thank her spouse, Patricia Phelps, her advisor and her hero, Dr. Kristen Lessie, her UCC endorsing agent, Reverend Stephen Boyd, Peace United Church of Christ, and the St. Louis Association of the United Church of Christ.
Daniel Tut-Leon.
Tut has been working as a missionary, lecturer, and pastor for more than 25 years. He currently serves as pastor of Dallas Chin Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas, where he will continue to serve after graduation. Tut would like to express his heartfelt thanks to President Krause, Dr. Leslie, Dr. McCann, and the faculty for their support, encouragement, and patient supervision. He is proud to be a student and a graduate of Eden.
Renita Ann Mercado Heinzel.
Since 2001, Renita has served at St. Luke's Hospital in Chesterfield, Missouri, both as an ACPE supervisor and a senior chaplain. She is excited by the myriad of possibilities that lie ahead of her as she continues to love God by serving others. Renita would like to thank her husband, Dieter, for his love, support, patience, and encouragement at each step of the way. She'd also would like to thank her family, especially her father and Eden Seminary, especially Dr. Kristen Lessie and Dr. Jeff Moore, who believed in her even when she did not believe in herself. Finally, she would like to thank her colleagues at St. Luke's Hospital whose support made this possible.
Kimberly Pearl.
Kim serves as an online pastor at MissouriPastor.org. After graduation in this, her 30th year of ministry, she will continue as a full-time pastor in sacred spaces online and in person. A big thank you to Joe Pearl, her love and her rock, her children who grew into teens and adults while moms there earned a doctorate, her benefactors at the Church of the Nazarene who chose to partner with Eden in providing scholarships, and all the participants in her research. The space they shared with her is holy. Thanks also to Dr. McCann, Dr. Leslie, Donna Tetchu, Mary Ann Rennick, Marion Edmonds Allen, and all the girlfriends and Converge families who prayed her through. It is finished.
Adam Quine.
Adam currently serves as the Minister of Word and Sacrament Pastor of First Presbyterian Church in Lincoln, Illinois, and the Middletown Presbyterian Church of Middletown, Illinois. He looks forward to spending time with those he loves, adventuring with the dogs, and writing without worry about footnotes. He would like to thank his family, friends, and First Presbyterian Church for their unwavering support throughout his journey, as well as his faithful golden retrievers who kept vigil as he wrote, especially Chloe, the most educated pup he ever knew.
Please join us in congratulating this year's Doctor of Ministry candidate. Will the candidates for the Master of Divinity degree please rise in body or spirit? President Kraus and Chairperson Rowe, these candidates have satisfactorily completed the requirements for the degree Master of Divinity. On behalf of the faculty, it is my privilege to recommend them for the conferral of the degree.
As Chair of Eden Theological Seminary's Board of Trustees, I am pleased to receive the faculty's recommendation. In consultation with the members of the board, I commend these candidates to the president for the conferral of the degree.
By virtue of the authority granted to Eden Theological Seminary through its charter, and by action of the faculty and Board of Trustees, we confer upon you the degree Master of Divinity and declare you entitled to all attendant rights and privileges.
Paula Arbuthnot.
Paula's contextual education partners included Colonial Church in Prairie Village, Kansas, Jefferson Franklin Community Action Corporation, and St. Mark's United Church of Christ in Arnold. After graduation, her future will be part street ministry, helping unhoused people into affordable housing, and part pastoral ministry at a church. She would like to thank Richard Haskin, her son Mark, her husband, and her mentor, Pastor Kim Brinkman.
Angela Wentz Bjornstad.
Angela served at the Lord of Life Lutheran Church in Chesterfield, Missouri, St. Mark's Lutheran Church in Belleville, Illinois, and St. Thomas Episcopal Deaf Church in Crestwood, Missouri, for her contextual education. She hopes to begin the ordination process with the Episcopal Diocese of Missouri, but in the meantime, she will continue her work with St. Thomas's Deaf Church. She would like to thank her husband, Bill Bjornstad, who has been her rock through seminary. She would also like to thank the professors, staff, and students who believed in her even when she didn't believe in herself.
Jesse Donovan.
Jesse's contextual education partners included Abbey Road Christian Church DOC in Cape Girardeau and Emmanuel United Church of Christ in Jackson, Missouri, and Crown Hospice in Cape Girardeau. His goal is to become an ordained board-certified chaplain. He would like to thank his mom, Cheryl Donovan, his wife, Angela Donovan, Adelaide Parsons, Eden alumni, Joe Riley, and all of his Eden professors.
Josephine Ezenwa.
Josephine partnered with Sankofa Cultural and Arts Wellness Village and Episcopal Church of the Holy Communion for her contextual education. Following graduation, she will be heading off to Christ Church Cathedral in St. Louis to begin an internship as part of her discernment process for ordination. She will also continue working as a triage chaplain at St. Louis University Hospital. Josephine would like to thank the professors and staff at Eden for the deep impact they've made on her education, helping her to see a broader perspective. She is also grateful for her classmates for walking this path with her.
Brad Geary.
Brad's contextual education setting was the Oregon Baptist Church in Terre Haute, Indiana. After graduation, he will start the ordination process in the American Baptist Churches and plans to stay on as a pastor at Oregon Baptist as long as God sees fit. He would like to thank God for the opportunity to be at Eden and his family for supporting and encouraging him through his time in seminary.
Rachel Helton.
Rachel's contextual education service included Ascension Healthcare, Shepherd of the Hills Lutheran Church at St. Anne, and Cardinal Glennon Children's Hospital. After graduation, she will be answering a call to pediatric hospital chaplaincy. She will begin a CPE residency at Cardinal Glennon Children's Hospital in St. Louis in August and hopes to become ordained as a rostered leader in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Rachel would like to thank faculty, staff, and students for sharing their experiences and wisdom and for their commitment to bringing about God's justice and shalom in the world. She would also like to thank her family who walked with her along this journey, helping her to move deeper into the mystery of God and never complaining when it was Kraft mac and cheese again for dinner.
Christine Lippert.
Troy United Methodist Church was Christine's contextual education placement through seminary, where she served as director of children's ministry, a grief share counselor, marriage ministry coordinator, and pulpit supply all 4 years. After graduation, she will continue her ordination journey to be a United Methodist Church elder, seeking a full-time placement in the Illinois Great Rivers Conference. Christine would like to thank the staff at Troy UMC for trusting her to venture outside of children's ministry, the Eden community for becoming family, Journey Church, Union UMC, Troy UMC for sustaining her in the most trying times of her life, the friends and families who made up her cheerleading section when she was ready to give up, and most of all, her children, with thanks for encouraging her, understanding church and school commitments, and just being awesome.
Joyce McCowan.
Joyce's contextual education placements included Aberdeen Heights Senior Living, Kirkwood United Church of Christ, Webster Groves Christian Church, and Memorial Boulevard Christian Church. After graduation, she plans to continue the work of ministry in both the church and the community. She would like to thank her professors for all of their instruction, her contextual supervisors for helping her complete both contextual education and the progressive Christian leadership classes, and the contribution of the United Church of Christ to the completion of her education.
Gail McLaughlin.
Gail served at Union Congregational United Church of Christ in North Reading, Massachusetts for her contextual education. After graduation, she will continue as a minister of discipleship at Union Congregational. She is thankful to her husband, Rob, and daughter, Savannah and Ayla, who have had to adapt and find a new level of flexibility so that Gail could pursue her degree. She is also thankful to her church family, who has always gone above and beyond to be supportive and encourage her call, her friends and family who don't always understand her call, but are supportive anyway, and her Eden friends and professors who have become family.
Dion A. McKenzie.
Dion's contextual placement during the seminary was Christ the King United Church of Christ in Florissant, Missouri. After graduation, he will continue serving Emmanuel UCC in Ferguson, Missouri as their settled pastor. Prayerfully, he will be ordained in the United Church of Christ and then be installed as their senior pastor. He would like to thank all of his professors and especially his academic advisor, Dr. Wise Baker.
Kendall Moore.
Kendall's contextual education partnerships included St. Peter United Church of Christ in Houston, Texas, a summer fellowship with the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference, and RSL Ministries with Dr. Raquel Lexham. He hopes to enter congregational ministry and is engaged in search and call process of the United Church of Christ. He is also looking forward to seeing where God will take him in music ministry. Kendall would like to thank his wife, Carolyn, for her support, as well as his mother and father, brothers, and his chosen family, many of whom are here at Eden.
Chris Truesdale.
Truesdale partnered with Samuel United Church of Christ and Clayton and New Awakening United Methodist Church in Belnor for his contextual education. After graduation, he hopes to get his feet wet in pastoral ministry and then explore the possibility of a PhD in theology in order to teach at the intersection of science and faith. Truesdale would like to thank his parents, his sister, his friends for believing in him and helping him to stay sane. He would also like to thank his classmates and professors for being an amazing group of caring people. Pastors Jeff, Cherie, and Steve for guiding him on his journey. President Krause for being an awesome neighbor. And God for her persistence in calling him to this path, equipping him for the road ahead, loving him through frustration, doubt, and anger, and never giving up on him.
Please join us in congratulating this year's Master of Divinity graduates. Will the candidates for the Master of Arts in Professional Studies degree, please rise in body or spirit. President Krause and Chairperson Rowe, these candidates have satisfactorily completed the requirements for the degree Master of Arts in Professional Studies. On behalf of the faculty, it is my privilege to recommend them for the conferral of the degree.
As Chair of Eden Theological Seminary's Board of Trustees, I am pleased to receive the faculty's recommendation. In consultation with the members of the board, I commend these candidates to the president for the conferral of the degree.
By virtue of the authority granted to Eden Theological Seminary through its charter, and by action of the faculty and Board of Trustees, we confer upon you the degree Master of Arts, Professional Studies, and declare you entitled to all attendant rights and privileges.
Kiana Lasagna Grimmett.
Kiana plans to continue her education in order to help bring educational equity to the children of St. Louis. She would like to thank each of her professors for shaping her faith in new ways and helping her to find her purpose.
Janiquel Shanice Johnson.
Jay served as an organizer working on integrated voter engagement with Metropolitan Congregational United for her contextual education. After a long-awaited vacation this summer, she will continue her work embedded spiritual care doulas and chaplains into pastoral care teams to provide transitional care and maybe enter a DMIN program. Whoop, 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 whoop. She would like to thank everyone who edited a paper or dragged her through writing assignments, and most importantly, reminded her that she can do all things with a nap and a plan.
Valerie Eugenia Patton.
Valerie's contextual education partners were the organizations Faith and For the Sake of All and Faith Heals. After graduation, she plans to complete her formation process to become a deacon in the Episcopal Diocese of Missouri. She gives thanks to God, her mother, her deceased father, her grandfathers who were Baptist deacons, her priest, the Reverend Renee Fenner, her discernment committee, her field placement team, the village, and so many more. I am because we are. We are because I am.
Please join us in congratulating this year's Master of Arts in Professional Studies graduates. Will the candidates for the Master of Theological Studies degree please rise in body or spirit? President Krause and Chairperson Rowe, these candidates have satisfactorily completed the requirements for the degree Master of Theological Studies. On behalf of the faculty, it is my privilege to recommend them for the conferral of the degree.
As Chair of Eden Theological Seminary's Board of Trustees, I am pleased to receive the faculty's recommendation. In consultation with the members of the board, I commend these candidates to the president for the conferral of the degree.
By virtue of the authority granted to Eden Theological Seminary through its charter, and by action of the faculty and Board of Trustees, we confer upon you the degree Master of Theological Studies and declare you entitled to all attendant rights and privileges.
Beatrice Chirop.
Beatrice is one of the first women to be ordained in the Reformed Church of East Africa. While at Eden, she partnered with Mountain View United Church in Colorado as a sabbatical minister for 3 months. After graduation, she plans to use the pulpit as a space to advocate for the full participation of persons with disabilities, as well as other marginalized groups in the leadership and spiritual life of the church. Beatrice extends her sincere gratitude to the Eden administration and Board of Trustees for providing funds for her tuition and living expenses. She is thankful to Eden and its donors for supporting international students.
Lucy Erlina Pulamau.
Lucy looks forward to continuing her studies and being involved with her community. She has learned that life is beautiful, unpredictable, and fragile. And so she asked the Holy Spirit to lead her and help her to befriend the uncertainty. She would like to thank her family for their endless support, prayers, and love. She would also like to thank her supporters, Global Ministries of the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, and the United Church of Christ for supporting her study at Eden.
Please join us in congratulating this year's Master of Theological Studies graduates.
A charge to the class of 2023. There are certain times in history when people talk a lot about technology, and it tends to be when new forms are emerging. Technology is often blamed in these times for all of society's ills. Take, for example, in ancient Greece, the emergence of writing and the creation of books. Yes, class of 2023, I know it's hard to imagine that there was a time when books did not exist, because you've been under them for several months. But there was. The emergence of the book was seen by many, according to Plato, as the death of civilization, a debacle in which memory and story would be lost forever. The form of the letter, written on the newly engineered paper of papyrus and sent via a network of Roman imperial trade routes across the Greco-Roman world, was an emerging technology in the Apostle Paul's time. Writings we now call things like 1st and 2nd Corinthians, or 1 and 2 Corinthians, Philippians, Galatians, and Romans are examples of his adaptations of letter writing technology to support his ministry. Letters gave Paul a way to project himself into places where he could not physically be present in order to teach, encourage, inspire, and guide, and exhort and pray for his congregations. Think of them as Paul's take on the Zoom room. And people, including his own parishioners, mocked him for it. He records in 2 Corinthians 10:10 how his opponents charge, quote, "His letters are weighty and strong, but his bodily presence is weak and his speech is contemptible." That, by the way, really hurt his feelings. Nonetheless, he kept adapting the technology of the letter to pursue what he trusted to be his part in pursuing God's purpose to redeem the whole world. Paul took components of the letter typically dedicated to culturally expected preliminaries and afterthoughts, such as thanksgivings and greetings, and expanded these sections to lead his communities in practices of ministry, such as faith formation and community organizing. With his thanksgivings, he drenched his congregations, like the one in Philippi, in the theological imagination that the God of Israel and not the Roman emperor is sovereign over all creation, and that it is in the power of God's Holy Spirit and not the power of Rome that we live and move and have our being. Likewise, Paul expanded the greeting sections of his letters from a pro forma cultural convention to an active practice of community organizing. That's right, Dr. Weisbaker. Building power by connecting different members of his various congregations. In Paul's adaptations, the greetings knit together members across geographical distance to demonstrate how in God's Spirit, no matter where we are, we all belong to God's creative, redemptive, and reparative work, and we all have a role to play. Sound familiar, class of 2023? To us up here, that is all you. As you graduate, we, the faculty and staff of Eden, can confidently say that we have never known a class at once as adaptive to disruption and the danger and opportunity of the emergence of new technologies than you. And over these years here at Eden, you have borne the challenge of this school's massive and grinding gear shifts from primarily in-person instruction to our emerging, fledgling, blended community of digitally and physically present teachers and learners. And you did so somehow as you worked, as you pastored, as you parented, as you partnered, and as you lived through a deadly global pandemic in a time of rising Christofascism, racism, sexism, and heterosexism. If you are tired tonight, that just might be why. And through it all, you have not merely survived, but you have adapted and thrived to lead this school into its new emerging forms that are creating greater access and opportunity for more and more people to the gifts of an unapologetically progressive theological education. Thanks be to God. So our charge to you tonight, class of 2023, is that you continue to build like Paul, adapting emerging technologies that many rightly fear and loathe, and to re-engineer them for God's good purpose. Expand on what you have learned and innovated, and sometimes needed to teach us on the faculty, to create new modes of ministry and fellowship, and new forums for beloved community. Knit together, as you have for one another, the bonds of support, collaboration, and care that will sustain your ministries going forward and will inspire the communities you serve to know that in this world that serves up domination and degradation to God's people and creation, we are called to be agents of God's justice, mercy, and love. And we will be watching you. Yes, sometimes via Meta's diabolical platforms or Google's analytics. And we will be praying for you, always in the power of the Holy Spirit. And yes, we will still be learning from you with pride and great gratitude in all the ways you are breaking open and adapting God's resources to serve God's people and all creation. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Want me to hold this mic? They know I won't do that.
As we prepare to leave this place, we leave this place knowing that we are Eden. Yeah. We leave this place knowing that we are not perfect. We leave this place in all of our colors and shapes and sexualities, but we leave this place knowing that there is a call on our life. And that our one essential charge, no matter what part of ministry we go to, is to follow Jesus. So when you leave this place with the love of God in your heart, leave this place knowing that even though there may be wounds and hurts, there's resurrection and there is restoration. So when you leave this place determined to model, to be the beloved community. Shalom.
My feet while I run this race. Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. Lord, guide my feet while I run this race. I don't want to run this race. While I run this race, Lord, hold my hand. While I run this race, Lord, hold my hand. While I run this race, I don't want to run this race in vain. Hey, Lord, I'm your child. While I run this race, Lord, I'm your child. While I run this race, Lord, I'm your child. While I run this race, I don't want to run this race. Yeah, Lord, guide my feet. While I run this race, Lord, guide my feet. While I run this race, Lord, guide my feet. While I run this race, so I want to run this race in vain. Lord, hold my hand. While I run this race, Lord, hold my hand. While I run this race, Lord, hold my hand. While I run this race, Lord, I don't want to run this race. Lord, I don't
want to run this race in vain.
Let's say it one more time. Guide, Lord, guide my feet while I run.